When you modify catalyst, you increase amount of acetic acid, but you slightly increase only carbon dioxide. So this is still a problem how to deal it. And brief example, the most promising probably results so far we have received is to combine different catalytic systems to form, I would say, nanoreactor. So you have the zirconia oxide, which provides OH groups. These OH groups can help with the removal of CO. And you have another metal, and poloxymethylate now is a binder, because zirconia is positively charged. And can you imagine a situation we can introduce another noble metal, is rhodium. And rhodium has a capability to induce C-C bond splitting. It's not electrochemically particularly active in the process. And it is mapping of the system. You have both rhodium, tungsten from the tank state, zirconia on the, in the interface. And it's a drastic increase in the current. And you see the bubbles of carbon dioxide. So this is a case where you can increase activity, but still you are not at 100% of carbon dioxide, maybe 50. So the chemical step is breaking of the C-C bond with help of ruthenium. Okay, now another example of catalysis. We talk a lot about carbon dioxide. I will keep it briefly, not spend too much time. Maybe I will go to those aspects of general interest. This carbon dioxide, there is a problem that you need to have large overpotential. One of the approaches is hydrogenation. And this you can do by palladium. And we have found that, and this is actually promising with respect to conducting polymers, that supposedly, initially we thought that organic species would poison noble metal. But we use a shift, tridentate shift-based ligand, supramolar structure, where palladium was ionic first. Then we reduced it. We even observed hydrogen evolution. So it was a palladium nanoparticle surrounded by the organic network of oxygens and nitrogens. And very nice particles. We can compare it to conventional particles. And we found drastic increase of current, despite the fact that some palladium might be poisoned. So I think there is a sense of thinking about of certain conducting polymers with free groups, nitrogen, oxygen groups, or at least capable to interact with noble metals, because we know it from different experiments from FTR. I don't show it because we got it 2 days ago, that there is a strong interaction. And despite that, even the surface area active is measured from the amount of the hydrogen peaks of palladium in the organic ligand is smaller, we have much higher currents. We know that the main product is CO. Maybe I'll skip this part because these are details. But I would like to say that the activating role of ligand, which is organic ligand, is nitrogen-oxygen group, can be explained by interaction. I also mentioned here third body effect. We don't have proof from XPS because the XPS machine we are using was not sensitive enough in this case. But we know that there is interaction between palladium and those species. Okay, and another example of photoelectrochemical reduction of carbon dioxide. This is a literature example where they use titania and they produce even CH4. But we decided for different system, copper one oxide as a semiconducting materials, because copper one oxide can absorb visible light. So titanium is here plays more a physical role, though there are some different opinions in literature how titanium may behave in together with copper one oxide for different applications. But copper one oxide has a very low band gap, relatively, so absorb visible light. The problem is that it requires stabilization. And if we look at the positions of the, let's say, copper one oxide, if we compare the energy in electronvolts to the potential scale of the certain chemical reactions, we may expect that once electron is in conduction band, may drive the reduction of carbon dioxide to methanol, possibly to CH4, possibly to formic acid, and even CO to some extent. This is what we can expect easily. With titania, the problem is that we need a much larger, much lower wavelength light, like UV. Therefore, in this experiment is rather inactive. So we prepared a mixed system where copper monoxide was stabilized with titania. And we can see both from XRD presence of both components. Titania was nanostructured, fairly porous. Copper monoxide was microstructured, prepared by classical means described in literature. There has been a postulate in literature, in a different application, that titania may work like a dye in dye synthesized solar cells. Sorry, copper monoxide may work like a dye for titania, and a comparison has been made to dye synthesized solar cells. Copper is absorbing visible light, it gets excited, and introduces electrons to the titania. I don't think so is fully operative this case, because it's still large energetic difference, but certainly stabilization effect is possible. And if we compare spectra of different systems under different conditions, we can see that the systems copper monoxide is absorbing, this is a hybrid system, is absorbing in a proper wavelength. Indeed, during the photo experiment, we observe formation of the photocurrents in the presence of carbon dioxide. And it is quite effective system for the reduction of CO2. Copper monoxide was demonstrated by Krishna Rajeshwar to work itself. We have found that this system is even more selective because the main product for the reduction from gas chromatographic analysis is methanol. So if I conclude that part, that there is a possibility, and in this respect, I believe, and we have some results, that certain conducting polymers may stabilize copper monoxide on condition that you will prepare them avoiding acidic medium. So polyaniline, that will be the best. It's unfortunately a little bit devastating. However, the system works nicely. And the last part, last 5-7 minutes, I would like to spend on water splitting and go back to the classic experiment of Fujishima Honda from 1972 in Japan, where they used titania, and they combined with a simple platinum. If I go back to the position of band gaps, the difference is larger than 123 volts. So you can basically, since platinum is a good catalyst for the hydrogen evolution, you can drive oxidation of water to oxygen due to the presence of holes. The problem is that the UV light it worked on the Mount Fuji in Japan. It would work, I'm not sure it would work even on this mountain here, but maybe in the Alps it would work nice. But UV light, titania is only sensitive to a very small fraction of UV light. And you will see here, it's only a small fraction of UV light. Somewhat better is tungsten oxide and iron oxide, but iron oxide is a little bit unstable. Gallium arsenide is better, but it's, from other point of view, toxic. So if we go to the tungsten oxide as a nanostructured material, it absorbs slightly above 400 nanometers, so it is already in a visible light. The problem is that we are not at the 500 nanometers. So we need to enhance light absorption at the interface. And in this respect, we have introduced gold nanoparticles on the surface to expecting the plasmonic effect to be operative. And indeed, gold nanoparticles with poloxometallate occurred to be active. We have found that if you use gold nanoparticles modified with organic ligands, they are much less active. So it means that there is also some catalytic effect. We know now that they are originating from poloxometallates as well. So we know that we have poloxometallate on the surface. This is gold nanoparticles. It's interesting. Monolayer of poloxometallate is so strongly adsorbed that even if you go to 300 degrees, there is low degree of coalescing. fluorescence. If you go to 500, of course it is. And in a simple experiment, when you use visible light, and if you illuminate, we know when you have gold nanoparticles on the top or under the tungsten oxide film, which is a photosensitive, you have a much larger oxidation currents when you have gold on the top. And it is well behaved. You can repeat experiments under, you know, pulsing conditions. Using SNOM microscope, we can probe in a transmission mode, or we can probe in inverted transmission mode, where we illuminate from the bottom, and then the SNOM is a probe to see. We see clearly that the light transmission is the highest for the gold on the top. It's a completely different pattern. So this is probably consistent with the plasmonic effect as well. So to conclude that part, I would like to say that gold nanoparticles could act also as a introduce plasmonic effect, and when combined with a proper photosensitive system, may lead to the interesting result in water splitting. Of course, that experiment has to be done technically in a practical manner using the tandem fuel cell, tandem solar cell, but still the effect is interesting. Well, we work also a lot with disynthesized solar cells on charge relays, and this is an example where disynthesized solar cell uses a dye on the top of titania and absorbs visible light, and it says cheats with titania because titania needs UV light, but an electron can go to the conduction band. Problem is that mediators are the typical mediators, by far probably the best mediator because it's stable in visible light. The problem is a breaking II bond is a limiting factor. So high activation energy, and you lose a lot on this. So we decided, of course, if you work in a liquid state, you may deal with this problem because you may have a lot of iodine, iodide, and simple physical diffusion will solve the problem. But if you want to use a semi-solid system, it is our collaboration with Michael Gretzel, and if you use, for example, ionic liquids, which are semi-solid, then the limited physical diffusion starts to be a problem. So we need to have alternate transfer of electron in the iodine-iodide system, let's say hopping mechanism. And to do it, we have used the combination of ionic liquids with iodine-iodide couple, but we also added palladium as a catalyst for breaking the II bond. Palladium, very small palladium nanoparticles. They will not affect the visible conditions, but they will change. Palladium is used as a counter electrode, but people, they forget that the charge relay in a semi-solid conditions has to have very fast transfer in the bulk too. And we also use platinum. So the first part I will show today only on platinum. Palladium is probably the most promising at this stage. And we see that platinum may affect electrochemistry, and iodine is absorbed as a monoatomic. So it strongly interacts with the II bond. It is known from the old literature from the 80s, from the surface science. And both in a dummy cell, so-called current potential difference condition without solar cell, we see much higher currents. It means much better charge propagation. We have done very careful analysis. Also, you can comment on the actual rates. But in an actual solar cell, we also have better result in practice using platinum. At present, we work with palladium, and which seems to be even better catalyst. But soon, I will also talk about this. So briefly speaking, electrocatalysis is useful when you accelerate charge transfer in the charge relay electrolyte. And finally, as an example of the system, is combining forming a photocapacitance electronic, semi-electronic device. It means combining a capacitor, electrochemical capacitor, with a photosystem. So it's a three-electrode system and the counter-electrode in between. Can you imagine disynthesized solar in a counter-electrode in between, where on the left side we use a polymer Hall conducting polymer. On the right side, we use a semi-solid ruthenium oxide base capacitor. That issue is quite important because you can also use conducting polymers, except there is a question of the interfacial potentials between different systems, and in this respect, ruthenium was better. Ruthenium is quite expensive, but is extremely efficient charge propagating material. So let's look at that part. This is a die on titania here. Here is the polymer, which is used as a charge relay. So it's a completely solid system. It's a whole transporting material, P3HT. It is not a perfect behavior of the die synthesized solar cell, but it's solid. It should be ideal as a rectangle. And from the viewpoint of the capacitor, we have a very nice behavior of a capacitor and very nice characteristic, very nice specific capacitance using the ruthenium oxide. I would say, using the proper terminology, the pseudo-capacitor, because it is capacitor according to Conway should be a carbon material with double layer, but it behaves like capacitor, truly. When it comes to the charging, discharging, you see that depending on how much sun was used during charging, you have a little bit different performances, but obviously at 100% sun, you have photocapacitor charging more effective than at lower sun. Also, the voltage recorded versus time, you see that the best situation, the fastest change you have with when you use the full illumination, 100% sun. When you go to the discharging step, which can be in under dark conditions, depending on discharging currents, you have different patterns, but the system is well behavior. Well, Coulombic efficiency is not ideal at 100%, and the global conversion efficiency is below 1%. But if you take into account that we are dealing with system which is a truly solid, the result is, in my opinion, quite promising. And finally, how it works. You know, when you charge, you don't use the middle part. So it works like a disynthesized solar cell. When you discharge, you use a counter electron in between silver. Silver is not perfect, but unfortunately, gold is not as good as silver. Silver is a little bit corrosive, but it very nicely forms very nice interface with the polymer, whole conducting polymer. And is not destroyed by ruthenium oxide. At least in the middle, you have relatively low potentials. So you can discharge using silver, and the FTO is a glass conducting electrode, fluorine doped titanium oxide. So the system works nice. This work was done in collaboration with Anders Hackfeld, who prepared that interface. We prepared the capacitor part. So, to conclude, and finally to conclude my talk, using an example that in this respect, there is a lot of possibilities, and you may use also different polymers and different combination. You can prepare completely polymeric photocapacitor. At this stage, it's quite important that you may get quite reasonable efficiencies, despite that you operate in solid state. I would like to acknowledge people who did the work, also collaboration with number of people and the granting agencies for supporting this research. Thank you very much.
Thank you for this nice talk. Do we have any questions?
You told that you have this concerning the heterophthalic acid, that you transform your heterophthalic acid into a salt with one proton remaining.
Yeah.
It was still shown very high proton conductivity. And this is surprising because when I remember from the first year of my studies that if you have multi-proton acid, the dissociation constant of the first, second proton with respect to the first proton with respect to the dissociation constant of the second proton is like 10 to the fifth, and the third is even higher. So So maybe you have a mixture of an acid and a salt.
Well, that's a point. I agree with you. However, let me tell you, the Japanese who use those systems for catalysis, they tend to prove that in the presence of rubidium and cesium, that proton is still mobile and the system is still very acidic. If you add with sodium or potassium, the situation is different. However, I agree with you. It's very likely that the interface, I mean, what is covering such a salt, it could be more polyacid, counter ion free. Yeah, I think so. It's a possibility. Strong.
And you always use the notion monolayer. How do you know that you have monolayer?
No. This weekend, when we use a monolayer on platinum, particle on platinum, because it's very easy to determine the surface area true of platinum before modification, after, because before modification you can find from hydrogen peaks. Okay. In sulfuric acid, now it's close to monolayer. I don't want to say it's 100%. It's a little bit above monolayer typically, but during operation you get a monolayer.
But you can have multilayer.
You can make a multi-layer system.
It does not cover totally your...
That's a possibility. That's a possibility. We cannot exclude this possibility. But still, most likely, the metallic properties of the platinum are changed by the... Because when you use tungsten oxide, for sure you don't have a full coverage. You have islands only. So I think it's something like selenium with ruthenium. You don't have a full monolayer. The problem is that those monolayer coverages are not stable.